Dark. On the surface, they seem to be two complete opposites. Can they dwell together? And what's the dividing point? What's the difference between light and dark? Now, as I start out in this, my latest sojourn in the scriptures, once again, down here at the park, it's a very, very chilly mid-August, late winter's afternoon here. On the New South Wales Central Coast, it's August 12. It's a Friday afternoon, and it's about 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and I'm up to Psalm 38 just down there. And just on that again, I finished the scriptures a while ago, a couple of weeks ago, and at the moment I'm reading Psalm, and then after that I'm going to read the last 28 pages of the Old Testament again, and then it's the plan to read the New Testament. I don't know whether it'll be the whole lot, but most certainly a large part of it. And then it's the plan to start again at Genesis 1. That's the plan. That's the plan at the moment. So light and dark. Light and dark. Now, as I go on in this walk, I'm seeing it all started. It all started for me when I saw in that word parable in the New Testament that a part of the definition of that Greek word is that a parable is a earthly story, but it's got a heavenly meaning. So the Lord Jesus Christ is describing heaven through the eyes of an earthly story. Now, I'm also seeing everything that we see in the scriptures, we also see in the creation. For example, I know in my heart that there's something significant on the earth about the number 12. We've got 12 tribes of Israel. We've got 12 fruits in the new city. In Revelation, is it 22? The number 12 in the scriptures, the 12 disciples, is absolutely significant. So I know that on the earth, there's something absolutely significant going on with the number 12. Whether it's physical fruits or not, I'm not sure. We've got the figs and we've got the olives, for example, and pomegranates, all of these fruits. And for me, Paul gives us some in Galatians 5, the fruits of the Spirit. So the fruits of the Spirit are righteousness and peace and love and the fruits of righteousness of the gospel of peace, love and truth. But I see in the scriptures potentially that they all relate to a fruit on the earth. So when you offer somebody an olive branch, you're offering peace. You're offering to mend up something that's broken, the olive branch. So potentially the olive, it pertains to peace. And that's what I see with the olive tree in Romans 11. It's the tree of peace. And some of the branches of that tree had to be broken off because they weren't of peace. Peace be unto you, teaching of peace, the gospel of peace, love and truth. Now, I'm starting to see, because I've been putting this down for a while, that the progression of faith, it's gradual. I've been seeing that for a long time. But the old man has to die so that the Lord Jesus Christ can move in. And then it's by sufferings that the Lord Jesus Christ in us is glorified. So I'm seeing it as it's gradual. The Galatians 5 purge, all of those old unclean spirits, they exit the house of the Lord. They exit Jerusalem, the body of Christ, we as individuals, and as a collective, and the Holy Spirits move in. So I look at the moon, I've been looking at the sky my whole life, and the moon is something that absolutely fascinates me. So I come back to the original question about light and dark. What's the dividing point, and can they actually dwell together? Because like when I go for my walk of a morning, I go for my walk at about 4 o'clock in the morning, 4:30 in the morning, and at the moment that's about 2 hours before sunrise. And it's dark, but there's different mornings, there's different levels of light. Now that could be a mixture of the stars, and also I notice when it's cloudy, it's a lot brighter some mornings, and that could be potentially the artificial light on the earth gets trapped in and gets reflected. Potentially. It could even be coming off the clouds. Potentially. But you go into the furthest outback where there's no light at all and it's cloudy, it'll be absolutely, it'll be pitch black, right? Now you get, if the moon's out, you get some light, and the moon's coming in hard now, and the stars, they'll also give some light on the earth. But if it's a new moon and it's cloudy, it'd be pitch black. It'd be absolutely pitch black. So now I'm starting to look at the moon and I think, well, okay, when the moon is new, you can't see it because there's absolutely no light in it. But when it's full, you can see it in its full brightness. It's full brightness in the nighttime sky. You can see 100% of it because it's full of light. Now, when it's half, the other half is dark. And that's what I'm seeing with the progression of faith. For me, light and dark are two completely different things, but it depends the level of the, they're opposites. They're complete opposites, good and evil. But the amount of light that's present determines the amount of darkness that's present. And that's what I'm seeing with the half moon. Because it's half lit, that means it's only half bright, which means there's still half darkness. So in the progression of faith, we start off in the complete darkness, the blackness, which is the new moon, but the outcome of the progression of faith is the glorious full moon that's full of light. So that's how I'm starting to see light now, because we can't, there's no light, it's pitch black, unless there's some light present. Darkness is the absence of light. Now, we now apply that spiritually, and of course the light is the Holy Spirit. Now, when I put something like this down, I've got to be like quite careful, right? Because how can light and dark dwell together where the Holy Spirit's present? But I know here now I'm not perfect. I'm not perfected. I'm not pure. I don't have 100% faith because I haven't, to me, there's certain things, because I don't know the perfect knowledge of the perfect will of God, for starters. And I haven't had experiences where it's been tested to that point yet, where I've got that 100% faith. So I'm not, and for me, there's still deception present, because you learn every day. Every time you learn something new about the world, you learn about deception. So that means to learn about that deception you were once deceived. So I'm seeing that darkness is most certainly still, it's still present in the body of Christ, because we're not perfected. That's why we're still here. And I come back to the allegory of the moon. So that's what I'm seeing. Now, I've been seeing this for a while as well, is that I'm seeing that the earth pertains to the flesh, sin, corruptions, and it's temporal, and it's death, and it's Satan. And I'm seeing the heaven, it's the spirit, it's incorruption, it's eternal life, and it's Jehovah. It's the Holy Spirit. Time, right? Time is money. Time here on planet Babylon is money, and in the eternal kingdom, there's no time, because we no longer need to buy time. So what are Satan's biggest devices? For me, it's deception. That's his biggest one. But also it's the fear of death, and it's the threatening of terrorizing people financially if you don't do what he says, right? Our testimony. So I'll just go to it, right? So we had an election here about 3 months ago, a federal election. Now, my testimony has told me that I'm not to vote. For me now to vote in one of these elections, in one of these Masonic Theatre elections, it would be a grave sin, because it goes against my testimony. The way that I was brought into the body of Christ was due to me being shown the evils of the world, being awoken. I was awake in the dark for about 2 years. I didn't know the Lord Jesus Christ for the first 2 years, so I was awake in the dark. I was like the new moon, who was just awake, and I was angry. I had none of the fruits of the Spirit, and I had been awoken. I'd been awoken. But that's my testimony of coming into the body of Christ. So for me now, and one of the first things I saw was just how politics and all the rest of it, it's just completely corrupt. Every single last part of it is corrupt. So for me now to participate in something that's based on corruption and lies, for me, that's a grave sin. So I'm not to vote. My testimony determines that I'm not to vote. My testimony. So what's my testimony? The testimony is the Holy Spirit that dwells within me. My testimony is the light that dwells within me. As the light increases, as the darkness decreases, the progression of faith, and that's done by faith. And how do we earn more faith? We earn more faith by backing our testimony. We back our testimony, and then the Lord gives us more opportunities. He gives us more grace. We back our testimony. We do that by faith, and we will be rewarded with more faith and with an increased testimony as the darkness continues to fade away, because the light increases. The moon. That's what I'm seeing here in the body of Christ. The moon is an allegory from the new moon to the full moon, not from the full to the new. I'm seeing it as an allegory. It's an allegory to the body of Christ. Now, that I got the fine. So they here in Australia, it's compulsory. I'll say that in inverted commas. It's compulsory here to vote. Now, I'll cover where my address is, but that it come this morning. So that's my penalty notice there for not voting, right? So I've now been financially terrorized by the government for backing my testimony. But here's the thing. The amount due, you see it down there, I don't know if it's coming up. The amount due is $20, right? It's $20, so that's nothing. That's nothing. So what do I do now? Do I pay that? So what does your testimony say, right? So it's not about pride, it's not about ego, it's about what my testimony says. So what does my testimony say? What is my testimony? What's it directing me to do in terms of this fine? Now, do I now go and appeal to Caesar, knowing that the whole system is corrupt, or do I just pay it? For me, my conscience will not allow me to pay that fine. No way in the world. No way in the world will my conscience allow me to pay that fine. So I'm going to fight it. They've got a little, not very much. There's only about three lines there where they say where you can appeal, but then you've got to add a piece of paper if you want to. And I've got to do it in handwriting, which isn't my strong suit, because probably by about the second letter I'll make a mistake. So it'll have to be done in pencil. But you have to. So I'm going to make it very, very brief. Very brief and concise, and just back my testimony. But what my testimony is now telling me is that the Holy Spirit, he wants me to question this fine. So my testimony is in Christ, because I thought my faith is in Christ, thus my testimony is in Christ, because I thought the fine was like hundreds of dollars, but it's not. It's only 20 bucks. It's just like a processing fee. They can save themselves their processing fee by not tracking it, right? But in my heart of hearts, I can't participate in something that's based on lies, that's based on falsehood, that's completely corrupt, that needs people to be forced to participate in for it to have any meaning at all. Otherwise, people wouldn't do it here. No one would vote here. Hardly anyone would vote here if it wasn't compulsory. So they force you. They financially terrorize you and force you to participate in their Masonic ritual. So now my testimony is dictating to me that I've now got to fight that fine. So it's going to be interesting to see where it goes, right? Now, I didn't do that. I didn't participate in that election because of my testimony. Now, a scripture that's really helped me understand more about what's actually going on here, I wasn't reading it right, and it came in a couple of reads ago in 1 Peter 3:21, where we get these brackets. The brackets, what's in these brackets here is very, very interesting indeed. When I see brackets, what I do the first time is I just skip over the part that's in the brackets, and then I go back and read the brackets. The light figure, so we're just talking about the example of Noah. The light figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us, right? So it's the actual baptism that saves us, because we actually read in verse 20 where they were saved by the water. They weren't saved from the water. They were actually saved by the water. And that's what happens to the body of Christ. The Holy Spirit, the old man can't begin to die, so the darkness leaves due to the light now being present. That can't commence without repentance. Repentance needs to be there, genuine, from the heart repentance. That's where the death of the old man commences. And that's the baptism of the water. The light figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us. Now, in the brackets, so I'll skip that. The light figure, also even unto baptism, does also now save us by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And then we read the brackets, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God. So not putting away the filth of the flesh, right? But it's all about the testimony of your conscience. So when I read that in the brackets this time, it really, really brought it to life, actually, what's going on here. No matter what we do in the flesh, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. What this is all about is having faith in God. What's that faith built on? It's built on our testimony, the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ that he gives us. Our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, and our testimony is the testimony of Jesus that's dwelling within us. So it's having faith in God. I get that fine, and I've got faith in God that everything's going to be okay. I didn't vote, and I'm fine. They can club me over the head, they can threaten, and they can huff and they can puff, they can do whatever they like, but I'm going to back my testimony, I'm going to have faith in my testimony, and I'm going to fear God, not what Satan can do to me. the testimony of our conscience. So it's, we don't try to put away the filth of the flesh. It's having that testimony. It's having faith in that testimony. That testimony being the Holy Spirit, which is the light. Which is the light. So it's, the moon is no longer new. The moon now has light. There now is light there. And as the progression of faith continues, so my faith has just increased by this, because the find's so small. And when I got it, it didn't overly bother me. In the past, I would have been quite spooked by getting a find like that. But I've got faith. I've just got faith. So I feel as though, as a result of this, I now have been given more light into my vessel, thus the darkness continues to recede in my tabernacle. Now this scripture in 1 Peter 3:21, it also reminds me of this one in Hebrews 6, where it really gets spelled out for me. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and faith toward God. So that's what it's about. It's not trying to uphold laws. It's not trying to uphold rules. It's not trying to uphold regulations and statutes and judgments. It's having faith in your testimony. It's having faith in the Holy Spirit that dwells within us, the light, the light. So I'm now at fever pitch, that the difference, the actual difference between the division, between light and dark, is the wisdom of God. Now, what's the opposite to the wisdom of God? The opposite to the wisdom of God is the wisdom of man. So I'm now getting there, that I'm now getting there of the view. It's very, very, I'm not 100% when I say this, but this is what I'm really starting to think now. That's what's coming in right now. Is that without the wisdom of God, without the Holy Spirit, you are evil in the eyes of the Lord. That word evil, the Hebrew word for evil, I haven't had a look at the Greek one, but the Hebrew word for evil that we first see in, it'd be the knowledge, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It's a very, very varied word indeed. That division is the wisdom of God, the knowledge of God, which is the Holy Spirit within. So in God's eyes, until you repent, I'm now being led to think that you're evil in God's eyes. Belief in the Lord Jesus Christ and that fear of the Lord. And back in Psalm 99:4, that's the equity. So the Lord's going to judge, and the equity is the belief in the Lord Jesus Christ and the fear of the Lord. And the outcome of that judgment is either going to be righteousness or iniquity. And that's what I'm seeing now, the division between light and dark, good and evil, is the wisdom of God over the wisdom of man. And that's why I've just been reading in Jeremiah, because we read in Romans that they stumbled at that stumbling stone of faith. The Lord Jesus Christ is the chief cornerstone in the house, and that chief cornerstone is faith. That's the anchor point of the body of Christ, having faith in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, and having faith in your testimony. And they stumbled at that stumbling stone, faith, because they were walking after the imaginations of their own evil heart, because they didn't know God, they didn't have faith in God. And we read in the Old Testament the Lord's statutes and the Lord's testimonies. He gave them testimony. When they come out of Egypt over the Red Sea, he gave them testimony. All the way through those 40 years in the wilderness, he gave them a testimony, but they didn't believe him. They didn't have faith in him. They stumbled at that stumbling stone because they were walking after the imaginations of their own evil heart rather than searching for the knowledge of good. So now I am just at fever pitch that's the answer to that question, and I'm becoming more and more confident that everybody has the opportunity. Everybody has the opportunity to repent. So everybody at one stage in their life, they hear the word of God. And it most certainly happened in the Old Testament, because in Isaiah 45, all flesh shall see the salvation of God. How that actually took place, I'm still not 100%, and I'm going to talk about that again today. Well, that's the plan in any case. So I'm looking here at the run sheet, and it's grown again. And I, as I sit here now, I'm not going to say that I'm going to get to Thessalonians today. It's 2 Thessalonians 1, I think. But me and these numbers, right? You can never, ever tell. But the run sheets, it's increasing. I'm going to refrain from recapping today to an extent. I can't avoid it also as well, because it's going to be a bit, I'm going to say the same things because it's the same message, right? But it's evolving. It's evolving. I'm learning more about all this, and there's more scriptures to bring in. But it's the same message, but I'm increasing in the knowledge of this message. So it's one of those videos where you probably, if you want to get the full benefit, if you like, out of it, for whatever good, whatever benefit my videos provide, but to watch the last one, probably the last few. I'm going to try and refrain because I've got a lot here. But I'm going to continue on today by talking about the glory of God being revealed and this meeting between, I'm seeing, between the celestial body of Christ and the terrestrial body of Christ. Because the 1 Peter 4:11, Peter's talking to the body of Christ about the way they behave, because if we behave in the gospel of peace, love and truth, the glory of God is going to be revealed, it is going to be made manifest. Thus the glory of God is going to be made manifest through the Lord Jesus Christ. As the question continues to abound, what's the difference, if indeed there is a difference, between the Lord Jesus Christ and the body of Christ? What's the difference between you and your body? And if there is a difference, what makes you you, and what actually makes up you if it's not your body? And I see the body as being what you see, the outer shell, but it's also all your inner organs, and it's your spirit, it's your soul, it's all of it. Everything about you, from your toenail to your eyes to your heart, everything makes up you. Makes up you. Otherwise, what is actually you? And then we come into the concept of me, which I'm not, which I'm absolutely not going to get into now. So I'll kick off this part of the video today. I'll come back into Romans 8, because Romans 8 continues to come into more and more focus for me. It's become an absolutely enormous piece of scripture. I'll go from Romans 8 and we'll go straight into verse 17. And if children, then heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ, if so that we suffer with him, that we also may be glorified together. So the glory of the Lord is going to be revealed. He's going to be revealed for me through. We get this in verse 18. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. In us, the light, right? The light. The light now that dwells within us, the Holy Spirit, our testimony. Our testimony by faith, as our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, revealed in us. In us. Now, in Hebrews, yeah, we'll go here. In Hebrews, it's Hebrews 1:2, hath in these last times spoken unto us by his Son, who he hath appointed heir of all things, whom he also made the worlds. So plural worlds, right? Now the Lord Jesus Christ is the heir of all things. And in Romans 8, we're reading that the body of Christ are joint heirs with the Lord Jesus Christ. So that as children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, so be if we suffer with him, that we also may be glorified together. As we sit upon the throne with the Lord Jesus Christ, as he sat down with the Father on his throne, as we all become one. So the glory of God is going to be revealed in the body of Christ. Thus, the glory of God is revealed in the Lord Jesus Christ. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. Now, I get vexed with this one. I get vexed with this one because for me, once you receive the light, you then become a son, because the rebirth has commenced. You've been born. You're now a babe in Christ. you've been born. So you're a son of God. For the earnest expectation of the creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of God. This tells me that it ties in with verse 17 and 18, which is pertaining to the glory which shall be revealed in us. Future dated, right? Future dated. So I get vexed with this one. For the creature, now get this, for the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by the reason of him who had subjected the same in hope. So the creature was made subject to vanity. And I also get fixed with this one, not willingly, not willingly. So the Lord did it, but not willingly. But everything the Lord does is his will. But he did it not willingly. So I get vexed on that one as well. But the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who had subjected the same in hope. So that tells me that we've all been subject to the first man so that we can be saved by the second man. For we all die in Adam, but we all come alive in the Lord Jesus Christ. Adam has to die, that the Lord Jesus Christ comes to life in us. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption, right? The bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. The children of God. So the glorious liberty of the children of God, but we were subject to this bondage of corruption, this vanity, into the glorious liberty of the children of God. So this is the light and the dark. The Holy Spirit, the light coming in, the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ. So this for me is saying, we all know that's predestinated and the Lord's got He knows the end of the story before even the beginning of the story. But this is just more scripture that's now telling me that everything that happened before the rebirth had to happen so we could have the rebirth. The Lord wanted us to be in bondage to this corruption, the corruptible earth, Satan's earth, sin, death, corruption, temporal. Did I say death? Time, the time prison, right? So that we can now enjoy the glorious liberty of the children of God, the sons of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. Now get this, and not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. The first fruits of the Spirit. So that tells me that word first fruits here, it pertains to the babes in Christ. So the moon now has light. The light has come into the dark place. The first fruits of the Spirit, the babes in Christ. Even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. Everything is made new, but the old is regenerated. It's made new. The old is renewed. The old is regenerated. And that's the redemption of our body, the salvation, the saving of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? So that's a big deal for me as well, because that's what we're seeing in our walk on the earth, our progression of faith, is that it's faith in something that we can't actually see. It's faith in God. It's faith in the Spirit. It's faith of this, of the world that we're not in. We can't see it. That's where it's so glorious. It's done by that belief, that core belief we now have, that the Holy Spirit is true, and it's faith in our testimony, and it's faith, and it's that fear of the Lord, that he's in control of everything, and he's going to give us that expected end. But if we hope for that we see not, then we with patience wait for it. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. So I see that as unclean spirits. The infirmities, the unclean spirits, are the darkness that's still yet to be purged, because our testimony, our walk with the Holy Spirit, is not yet complete. So all the darkness hasn't yet been purged, because the light is increasing. Thus, the darkness, thus the darkness is decreasing. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession with our groanings, which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts, searches the hearts. So that's very, very interesting. That reminds me of a scripture in Proverbs, that the spirit of man is the candle of the Lord that searches all the parts of the belly. So God, he searches the hearts, and the seed is the word of God that's sown in our hearts. Knowing what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them that are called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, who he did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, right? The image of his Son. So our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're sons, he's the Son, and we're joint heirs as we all become one. And the body of Christ are going to be, the glory of God's going to be made manifest in us. Thus, the glory of God's going to be made manifest in the Lord Jesus Christ, because we've also been translated into his glorious image, conformed to the image of his Son. So the light, the Holy Spirit's that's within us. So everything the Lord Jesus Christ has, the body of Christ also are going to have, and we're going to be just like him. So for me, we're going to be just like what he was like in Matthew 17 when he was transfigured in front of them. And Peter tells us that actually happened in the Holy Mount. So I'm being led to think that actually happened in the heart of God. That happened on the throne. That happened in Zion, the heart of God that dwells in the body of Christ, in the temple of the Lord in Jerusalem, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Now, I've pondered this scripture quite a lot in the past, and now it's coming into sharper focus. The firstborn of many brethren. I'll just keep going the next couple. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, then he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. So what's our justification? Our justification is our faith, because that's the righteousness of God. We've got confidence in our testimony. We've got confidence. We've got faith in the Holy Spirit, the testimony, the Holy Spirit that's now dwelling within us, also the life of the Lord Jesus Christ and all the scriptures, because that was all an example for our learning now. Them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. So it's fascinating, right? So the justification is our faith, and due to that faith, due to our testimony, having faith in that testimony, the Lord Jesus Christ, he's going to glorify us. He's going to glorify us. Thus the glory of God has been glorified within the body of Christ. Thus the glory of God has been revealed and made manifest in the Lord Jesus Christ. What shall we say then to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? So for me, it's that simple. What's going on is actually that simple. The simplicity of Christ, right? Now, that's the thing. The more your testimony grows, the more faith you have. And does it get easier? Does it get easier to have faith as you go? So the more light, the less dark. The higher the testimony, the less dark, because there's more light. So God's for us, don't worry about it. I see that fine. I'll get it back out. I see this fine, because it's not raining anymore. I see this fine, and whatever. As soon as I saw it in the letterbox, I knew what it was, but I know it's the Lord's will. I know me getting this fine is the will of the Holy Spirit. How do I know how to progress? Do I get emotional? Do I get angry? Do I want to show them? Do I want to teach them a lesson? Do I have to stand up for the truth? No, I've got to be good to my testimony. I do have to stand up for the truth, but that's always in our testimony. But it's not always that obvious what to do without testimony. So the more testimony we have, the more light that's dwelling within us, and the darkness is purged more and more and more, and we have more confidence. The more faith we've got, the more confidence that we have. I'm not going to say the word easier, but for me, it's not as difficult to have this faith as what it was when I first started, that's for sure. Faith now becomes natural. It starts to become more and more natural. But how do I, I don't know what I've done with it. How do I now guide my steps with this? How do I now plot my steps? How do I know what to do? It's my testimony. So I either do nothing, or I fight it, or I just pay it. You can't do nothing. You have to deal with it. You've got it. It needs to be dealt with one way or another. So I'm now down to two options. Do I appeal it? Do I appeal to Caesar? And that potentially goes against my testimony as well, because the whole thing's Masonic. The whole system's Masonic. So now I'm appealing to a corrupt Masonic system. But I know what I've done has been by the will of the Lord. My understanding now, due to my testimony, is that part of it's the police, when I got accosted by the police, a part of my testimony, right? I got accosted by the police. That's a part of my testimony. It's an essential. It is an essential part of my testimony now, me getting accosted by the police. I went all the way through to the end of those lockdowns, and the third last day, and I got accosted by the police, and I sit here now pretty much almost to the day, 6 months later, and the fine never arrived. Right, I've now got that confidence. I've now got that confidence to fight. The Holy Spirit wanted this to happen to me, so that you call them out. And I now look at this, you just say no. I've got faith in God. I've got faith in my testimony. So it gets hard, right? It gets really, really hard. But I just know in my spirit, the right thing to do due to my testimony is to write a letter and say, I'm not participating in this thing. I'm going to share them with a little part of my testimony, because you see on the letter, they don't give you a lot. It's that in purple, right? Interesting purple, interesting color for them, right? So they only give you like these one, two, three lines. So you don't get a lot of space. But what I'm thinking of doing is typing it on the computer and then writing it in my pencil, which is here somewhere. Writing it then in my pencil, because when I make my inevitable errors, I can just erase it out. But you can probably fit a little bit in those lines. What do you write? I write something like, it's funny how they word it. You must have a valid and sufficient reason for not voting. Well, my valid and sufficient reason is that you can't force me to do something that I don't want to do. You can't force me to participate in a ritual that I don't agree with. That's my valid reason. That's it. It's the same as the purple dragon juice. Why the demon juice? Why won't you get it? Well, the question is, why would you? Oh, we don't want to talk about that. I don't want to participate in madness. That's my valid excuse. That's it. But what do I write? To me, it's my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's faith in the testimony that the Lord Jesus Christ has given me. And it's a sin for me to participate in a system that's corrupt, that's devoid of any goodness, fear of God at all. It's built on lies, and threatening me with financial terrorism only just adds to the sin. Something like that, right? Something like that. I feel as though I can get it down. I can get down. Testimony of our conscience, right? Our testimony is absolutely everything. And already I'm 45 minutes in, and I knew this would happen. But coming back into Romans 8, I just got so much to say, right? And as I was getting ready this video today, because I want to talk about the chariots, but it's so far down here on my run sheet. It isn't funny. I've hardly even started. So I don't think I'm going to get to it today, of course, right? But as I got this video ready today, I just kept coming back to this. I couldn't avoid it. This trail that I'm seeing, and it's all about this word, it's all about this word first fruits. And we also get in verse 29, this word firstborn. Now, is this talking about the body of Christ, or is this talking about the Lord Jesus Christ? For me, this is talking about the body of Christ. Because in verse 28, and we know, because it's a whole chapter to now, has been talking about the sons of God being translated into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we know that all things work together, so the body of Christ jointly fit together, the building fitly framed for the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. So it's talking about the body of Christ, for whom he did foreknow, so it's still, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. So it's talking about the brothers and sisters in the body of Christ, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and them whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. So for me, this is talking about the body of Christ, right? The firstborn among many brethren. Now, is that how you feel? Because at the moment, my understanding of what's going on right now is that the body of Christ, we're scattered far and wide, and generally we're by ourselves. Sometimes you might be blessed enough to be married or have a friend or etc. But it's certainly my testimony that I'm on my own, and I've been on my own all the way through. I've got a friend now down at the shops, but I don't know which way he's going to go. In my heart, I feel as though I might, but I think he's going to be okay. But he's starting out now. He's only just starting out, right? Which is glorious. It's been an amazing, amazing experience for me. But all the way through, it's been my testimony that I've been all alone, and primarily people that have come forward and blessed me with their testimony, it's also their testimony that they're alone as well. So we're the firstborn among many brethren. Now, another question that I've asked over my journey is that, has this been going on? Has this been going on since the start, since the beginning of the creation? Actually, we'll go here now. I'm quite enjoying this. This is taking on a whole new, not whole new, but it's a little bit different to what I expected. I think this is going to be a video on its own, and it's nice to come to that realization about 50 or so minutes in. This is good because in Daniel 12, it's very interesting. We'll go from one. And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince, which standeth for the children of thy people. So it's interesting. He's the great prince. The Lord Jesus Christ is the prince of the princes, the Lord of hosts, the Lord Jesus Christ. Michael's the great prince, and he stands for the children of thy people. And that's what the Lord Jesus Christ does. Now, Michael's a member of the body of Christ. Michael is a member of the celestial body of Christ, and the glory of God is being revealed in Michael. Thus, the glory of the Lord is being revealed in the Lord Jesus Christ through Michael. And at that time shall Michael stand up, an H8269 prince, a captain of the host, the archangel, great prince, which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as there never was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, everyone shall be found written in the book. So it's at that time. It's at a particular time. This is a particular moment in history, I'm being led to think. I'm not being led to think that it's pertaining to individual people's lives. I see this, thy people shall be delivered. So it could be the same time as each person's progression of faith, potentially. But no, I'm seeing this as a time in history, as opposed to a time in individuals, people's lives over the period of history. Because we get such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time, thy people, plural, shall be delivered, everyone that shall be written in the book. Now, the big thing for me now, as it has been for a long time, is that now? Is that now? Because if that's actually now, we come back into Romans 8, and this now takes on all sorts of new meaning for me now, because we might be the firstborn among many brethren. Like the firstborn. So the firstborn to me indicates that it hasn't happened before. But what about all those brothers and sisters that have gone before us? The firstborn among many brethren. Has this been going on right through? But when we apply Romans 8:29 with Daniel 12:1, this is a particular moment in history. At that time, thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be written in the book. Now, this is the thing. This is very, very raw, and it's just a thought at the moment, but it's something that's been coming into me for quite some time. Are now the body of Christ, us, now, are we the firstborn? Are we the first fruits? Are we the firstborn among many brethren? The sent preachers, because now we come into, oh man, I'm right from the run sheet. Now, I had somebody help come and get me. He played a role in my first waking up. He hasn't played a huge role in my testimony since, but he played a role in me starting to wake up. Now, is it your testimony that you had a person involved in your waking up, or did it just happen through a series of events in your life? The first fruits of many brethren. So we come into Romans 10, and I'll pick it up at 13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on him who they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him who they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Now, I now apply this to my testimony, this person that I talk to down when I go and get my coffee, right? He was drawn to me by the Holy Spirit. Every day when I talk to this guy, every time he walks up to me and I talk to this person, every single conversation, the Bible comes up. And because that's pretty much all I want to talk about for a start, but it comes up in conversation because that's why he's been drawn to me. And I'm showing him the scriptures, I'm sharing with him my testimony, and I'm trying to help him understand what's going on in my life. As I share what's happening in my life. I'm strongly being led to think I have been sent because I'm one of those with beautiful feet who's preaching the gospel of peace and bringing glad tidings of good things. I'm strongly being led to think that that's what I'm doing with this person. I feel that's what I'm doing also on these videos. And I know that you out there are doing the same in your day-to-day walk. You're having people, you're having profound interactions. Sister Lisa in America, you for certain have the most intense interactions with people at the inn. You get to preach the gospel of glad tidings. Now, this is sort of where I'm coming from. If we are the firstborn among many brethren, that means we're the first. And there's going to be more that are born after us. If that's what's going on here, right? So we come back. I can't believe I'm doing this at the park. This would be a perfect one to be doing at home, but it just was not was kind of the plan, but anyway, we come back to Daniel 12. At that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince, which standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even that same time. And at that time, thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found in the written, that is written in the book. So this is the end. This is the end. Now, if that's where we are now, and we're the firstborn, because we are, aren't we? Like, there's nobody around here that I know of that loves the truth. My friend down at the shops, absolutely. But he's just starting now. He's just starting now. So I started out before him. Blessed enough to, right? It's nothing I've done. I'm just trying to understand potentially what's going on here, because I see that this potentially is here. So this if this is us, right? So get this in verse 2. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting contempt, because the word of God's been sown in their heart by the sent preachers, but they've rejected it. They've rejected it. They've woken up and they're drawn to us, the sent preachers, the firstborn, and they've rejected our testimony, thus they've rejected the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ. But those who accept us, so we shake the dust from our feet, but those who accept us, we say peace to that house, we eat what's ever before us, as we have our conversations on their level, trying to understand why they've been drawn, and those that receive us, actually receive the Lord Jesus Christ. Because if you reject the body of Christ, you reject the Lord Jesus Christ, as our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thus the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ is glorified when the glory of God's being revealed and being made manifest in the body of Christ. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. And they that be wise, right now get this, shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. So I've read that in the past and it's really got to me. Because in the early days, I was running around trying to wake people up, but nobody would wake up. But now I start to see that if we're the firstborn among many brethren, if we're the first fruits, if we're the firstborn among many brethren, the sent preachers, the first that have gone out, for me, that's what's coming for us. This is coming. Due to our progression of faith, as the light increases, the darkness diminishes, the Lord Jesus Christ sends his disciples out to preach the glad tidings. I now start to see that that is what might be going on here. So back in Romans 8 and verse 29, and it's all for me in this word firstborn. This word firstborn, it all hinges on this word firstborn and as to whether I'm in truth with what these scriptures mean. But for me, that's what this is saying. Members of the body of Christ, they're the firstborn among many brethren. So the Lord Jesus Christ is the firstborn. Yes, that's most certainly the case. But this for me in verse 29 is not talking about the Lord Jesus Christ per se. This is talking about members of the body of Christ. As I get asked the question, is there a difference? And what is the difference between the Lord Jesus Christ and the body of Christ? But we as individuals that make up that collective body, that's what I'm seeing here. He might be the firstborn among many brethren. And I see that word brethren, it's pertaining to brothers and sisters. The whole male, meet female thing in those scriptures gets quite confounding indeed at times. Brides and sons and the daughter of Zion. For me, the daughters of Zion are the sons of God. And Adam was created, the man was created, male and female. And for me, the woman, Hebrew word H802, that didn't appear. She didn't appear until the end of Genesis 2, but and Israel is the son, and Israel is also the bride. So it gets quite confounding, but that's what I see. That brothers and sisters in the body of Christ are the brethren. And I see, like, I apply this to myself, and it's certainly what I've seen with people that have blessed me with their testimony, that they're most certainly the firstborn among many brethren. And it just really starts to make me think now, when the Lord Jesus Christ said that a prophet's not welcome, a prophet's not listened to in their own country. Because that's certainly my testimony. There's no one really around here that's wanted to listen to me, unless now they've been drawn, which reminds me again, of course, of Daniel 12. So it's now the next day. It's now the Saturday. It's Saturday the 13th of, what is it, August? Yes, of course, it's windy, of August. And being a Saturday, there's a lot of people around, a lot of happy people enjoying their Saturday afternoon here in the park. I used to love that song, Chicago Saturday in the Park. Saturday in the park, I think it was the 4th of July. But lots of happy people around. So if you hear the voices in the background, that's what's going on. And naturally, it is windy. So I just pray for your patience and your understanding about the wind. There's not much I can do about the wind, and there's nothing I want to do about these happy voices. It's wonderful to see and hear people out there in this sunshine, intermittent sunshine. No, I can't say that word, but it's nice to see people out there all nice and happy, eating and drinking, right? Happily and given in marriage. But no, we're not there yet, because the mark of the beast, well, the beast hasn't yet been made manifest, but I need to stay on track. So that for me is the pivotal thing here. And I've been looking at it. This has been coming in for a long time. And that's what I'm seeing here in verse 29, that the firstborn among many brethren are indeed the body of Christ. The firstborn among many brethren. So has this been happening throughout the whole creation? Has what is happening to us now, has that been happening throughout all creation? Your whole life journey, have you ever met, particularly since you found the Lord Jesus Christ come and got you and you found him, have you ever seen anybody else before you, even after you were saved, even after all this started, have you seen anybody that's just like you, who've got the same ferocity of your love of the truth, your love of the Lord Jesus Christ, passion in the scriptures, but just this level of testimony? Have you ever seen it in anybody ever before? Have you ever seen it in anybody since all this started in you? For me, it's a resounding no. Not at all. I look through my whole journey. I grew up in a church, but I was only little then, and there were people who were, they seemed to be spiritual in that church, most certainly. So I don't know, not the ferocity that we've got, no way, not the testimony that we've got, no way. What I'm seeing now in the body of Christ, it is just the most profound thing going on. Psalm 51, man, but I'll get to that at the end. Psalm 51 has just blown my socks off this morning. So that for me is what this is saying in verse 29. So that I now look at that, the firstborn among many brethren, that tells me that there's going to be more born after that. Yet there is a dog, it's sitting in the driver's seat, it's locked in a bus, and it's barking for its owner. So I think we're going to have the company of this dog right throughout. So again, I apologize for that, but there's not much I can do apart from hope and pray that the owner comes at some point and lets that dog run around at the park like good owners should be doing, right? But anyway, it tells me that if there's a first, there has to be a second, right? The firstborn, because there's more to be born after the firstborn and the sent preachers. So have you had anybody in your past who's come to you and been a sent preacher? My John the Baptist, he didn't do that. He just started the process. He just started the waking up. It turns out he did come with the glad tidings, because where it's led me with the Holy Spirit, but he didn't do it in the scriptures. He did it through the evils of the world, right? So have you had anybody that's come to you and preached the glad tidings? And also along with that, have you yourself been preaching the glad tidings to other people, the firstborn. So back in Daniel 12, as I say, this verse 3, it used to really get to me because I was trying to wake people up and nobody would listen. And I had no impact. I felt like I was having no impact on anyone else. I was having no impact on anybody's life ever. Nobody wanted to hear me. Everybody just ran away. Because I used to see this every time I read Daniel, and they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. So it's interesting. So how are the firstborn, how are the members of the body of Christ that do this, how are they going to shine as bright as the firmament? The stars, right? Because that's what he's talking about, the righteousness as the stars forever and ever. And they that turn many to righteousness will, I see that as it's pertaining to shine, will shine as the stars forever and ever. Now, I'm strongly being led to think that stars, angels and spirits are the same thing at least some of the time and pretty much all the time. We've all got a spirit, which leads me to think we've all got an angel. Thus, we've all got a star. It's where I've been led for quite some time. The little ones in Matthew, is it 18? They've all got an angel in heaven. And when Rhoda constantly affirms in Acts 12, they said, just as a matter of fact, don't worry about it, Rhoda. You're mad. It's not Peter. It's just his angel. I'm being led to think that we've all got an angel. The Lord Jesus Christ most certainly has his own angel. Is that because all the angels are the angel of the Lord Jesus Christ? I'm being led to think it's because it's his angel. It's his Holy Spirit, the angel of the Lord Jesus Christ, just like you've got an angel, just like I've got an angel, just like everybody has a star. Well, members of the body of Christ at least, but I'm being led to think everybody. And depending on your level of testimony, that's how bright your star shines, because that's what we get here in Daniel. And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars. So they'll shine as the stars forever and ever. Now, I again draw on my testimony some of these conversations I'm having when I'm out and about now, just being led by the Spirit of God, allowing people to come to me. I had another conversation with that 78-year-old bloke today down at the shops. It was quite intense. He called me over and we just started talking, and it progressed to a point today where I asked him about the earth. He started talking about the spinning of planet earth, and I said, what makes you think it's a planet? And he went, what? And I said, can you show me ever where there's documented evidence, where there's scientific evidence that water bends on the earth? He said, well, water always finds its level. I said, exactly. So how does it cling to a ball? And he looked at me. And I then gave him the example of the plane. So you've got a plane. If you go from the other side of the ball Earth, from here is the east coast, the west coast of Africa. If you fly on a plane, you've got to be around the other way, because you start off facing the sky that way, and you finish off facing the sky that way. So you've had to turn around at some point. But when you fly on a plane, that plane never flips. It's always going in a flat line over the earth. Now, if you now jackhammer yourself through the earth to the other side of the ball earth, you're going to come out feet first, right? So how can the same object that gets to the same point two different ways, how can they arrive in a different state? Because there's no ball, right? And he looked at me and we started talking about money and the purple dragon. And I said to him, you ever followed the money? Or you ever heard that term? He said, yeah. I said, I did it with the purple dragon. And he said, yeah. He said, the pharmaceutical companies got very, very rich off that. I said, tells you something, doesn't it? I said, who owns the pharmaceutical companies? And he's looked at me. Profound conversations, right? So potentially, and I wasn't trying to wake him up. It was him. He called me over because we'd had conversations in the past. And my friend, he's coming closer and closer every day. And I'm not trying to reel him in. I'm just eating the meat that's before me. He comes to see me and we just chat. We just chat about himself, his life, as I relate it to my life and my testimony and the scriptures. So that's what I see in Daniel 12. And they're gonna shine as bright as the stars forever and ever, and they're gonna turn many to righteousness. Now, nobody's done that to me, and nobody's done that to you. But we're doing it, right? We're doing it. Now, this is where I'm coming from. Now, the next couple of scriptures I've been seeing for quite some time that they tie in. There's a sequence here. There's a theme going on here, and I'm just going to put them down now. And this is where this video is going to wind up. It's been amazing. What an amazing video to put down this one. It's just gone off into a completely different tangent. I'm going to try and keep it as close to 2 hours as I can, but I'm just going to keep going until it's done, because this is remarkable where this is leading me. And when I put this down, I want to make it absolutely clear that all I'm doing is asking questions and putting down where the scriptures are leading me, where they have been leading me for quite some time, as it now pertains to this, just this enormous giving to me of this new knowledge over the last couple of months, particularly since I got sick. Just this enormous outpouring of truth in those scriptures and the nature of our reality that the Holy Spirit has given me and other members of the body of Christ. These people that I'm about to talked about in those scriptures have to be somebody. They have to be somebody. Why can't it be, well, I'll leave that just for the minute. They have to be somebody. Do they necessarily have to be somebody else than us? I'm not saying that it is us, but that's the question. These people, they have to be somebody. So who are they? And I'm being led to think everything that I'm about to put down, well, not all of it, but big parts of it, they all interrelate. They're all pertaining. They're all pertaining to the same thing. Matthew 22, to me, this pertains to everybody in the body of Christ. And the other thing I want to put down as well is there's nothing outside the church. There's nothing outside of the body of Christ. Israel is the Lord Jesus Christ, and the inhabitants of Israel are the body of Christ. The sons of God and the Lord Jesus Christ will decide who are the sons of God, who are the inhabitants of Israel, not man-made doctrines. There's nothing outside the church. There's nothing outside the body of Christ. The body of Christ is Jerusalem, the temple of the Lord, and our heart is Zion, God's throne. I'm absolutely at fever pitch that that's what the truth is. But I'm far settled, long settled, that there's nothing outside the church. There's nothing outside of the body of Christ. So in Matthew 22 and verse 23, we've got the Sadducees. Now this is interesting, because this is what I've been putting down, that the Sadducees and the Pharisees seem to know about the resurrection. So if they know about the resurrection, they would have to know about the crucifixion. Now, the disciples had no idea because they were exceeding sorry. There's a couple of verses where the thing was held from them. They didn't know. The Holy Spirit kept it back. The knowledge of the resurrection, they had no idea because they were exceeding sorry, and the Lord hid that thing from them. But the Pharisees and the Sadducees knew. So how can that be? How can the Sadducees, and because the Sadducees don't believe in it. So in order to not believe in something, it has to be debated and has to be, you would have to be aware. You can't not believe in something. So I don't believe in the globe. I don't believe the globe's true because I know it's a thing. See, for me, in order to not believe in something, so that's a part of their doctrine. I don't believe. They don't believe in the resurrection, but they know it's a thing. They know they need to not believe in it. They know it exists as a doctrine. I think that's what I'm trying to say. The Pharisees, they believe in the, what was it? There's a point of difference. The Sadducees don't believe in angels and spirits and the resurrection. They don't believe in much, the old Sadducees, but the Pharisees believe in the resurrection, but they don't, well, do they? There's a difference. No, the Sadducees, they believe in the resurrection, but they also believe in spirits and angels. And that's what we get in Acts, that Paul used that. Paul used that against them so he could be free from their bonds. He used their doctrinal disputes against them. So that's what we're getting here in Matthew 22, verse 23. We've got the Sadducees, they're tempting the Lord Jesus Christ about the resurrection. Now, Jesus responds to them in verse 30. For in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are as the angels of God in heaven. So that tells me that at the very least, they're very similar to an angel. Potentially they are. They now have become an angel. And that's potentially what Daniel's talking about, that those who bring many to righteousness will shine as bright as the firmament. They'll shine as bright as the stars in heaven, because they are as the angels of God in heaven, because they're taking part in the resurrection. The second death is going to have no power over them, right? So the Lord Jesus Christ, that for me is what this says. But are as the angels of God in heaven. You now become one of them. You're now as them. You've become as an angel of God in heaven. That leads me to think that the body of Christ are all going to be Holy Spirits, plural, because as we become one in Jehovah, in the Lord Jesus Christ, in the Holy Spirit, we all become one in the house of God, the throne sitting in the house of God, we've all become Holy Spirits. That's what I'm being led to think. And this, for me, absolutely goes to the Lord Jesus Christ being transfigured and also we being changed into his glorious image because he's in the image of God. That's what the Lord Jesus Christ here is talking about for me in Matthew 22, verse 30. And this dog, I just know it's coming through and it's annoying me, so I suspect it's annoying you, but we just have to go on and be very, very nice if the owner would just let his dog go and run around. Who are the Hebrews? You ever thought about who the Hebrews actually are? So we don't get a Hebrew word for the word Hebrew as it pertains to the book of Hebrews. The word Hebrew, Paul uses it, absolutely appears in the New Testament. And just going on memory, it seems to pertain to the Jewish nation. It seems to pertain to, for me, the body of Christ. The Hebrews are the body of Christ. That's what it's pertaining to. It's not, absolutely. I see a difference in the Old Testament because Abraham was a Hebrew. That was the first time we saw it. It means one from beyond. Eber means region from beyond, and Eber's the lineage that goes down to Abraham. So it's in the Old Testament, and there's a difference. Joseph, just going on memory, also was a Hebrew, and we've got the Hebrews, they were striving. They were striving in Exodus. For me, there's a difference because the children of Israel were not made manifest until Jacob, but I'm being led to think it was right through because Israel means God prevails. And this is a big thing that I've learned today in Psalm 51, that the Lord has an inheritance and the body of Christ also has an inheritance, and the inheritance of the Lord are his people. And for me, that's Israel, that the glory of God can be made manifest in his people. But I do intend finishing out on that today. So who are the Hebrews? This is the thing that I was asking before and saying before, is that the Hebrews have to be someone. So do they have to be somebody else as opposed to the body of Christ, and in particular, a particular portion, a particular segment of the body of Christ? Because we've most certainly got the firstborn among many brethren. That for me says that there's going to be others that are going to be born after the firstborn. And I want this be good to get this scripture out of Dr. over in Hebrew, so I can actually say the word that I want to say here and stop being so careful. But that tells me that there's going to be more after the firstborn, and they're going to come into the body of Christ due to the sent preachers in Romans 10. And that's what Daniel's talking about. They're going to bring many to righteousness. They're a forerunner for me. They've gone out before. And because, anyway, I'll get back to all that in just a sec. But that's, for me, that's what First Fruits is talking about, right? So who are the Hebrews? Because in the book of Hebrews, for me, there is most certainly a progression going on. There is absolutely a progression going on. So some of my most favorite scriptures in all scripture. I use this a lot. Hebrews 12, and we'll come into 22. But ye are come into Mount Zion, the throne. So we're all becoming one. And unto the city of the living God, which is the heavenly Jerusalem, the house, the temple, and the throne Zion dwells within that. But we also get into an innumerable company of angels. So we're coming into the house of God, where the throne is. Revelation 4. All of the thunderings and the lightnings and the spirits and all the rest of it and the voices coming out of the throne. For me, that's where we are here in Hebrews 12. We've come into the throne, Mount Zion, the throne, and the city of the living God is the heavenly body of Christ, the glorified, completed work of the Lord Jesus Christ, Israel, Jeshurun, in all his glory, in all her glory. It might even be both in the Old Testament. But the her glory, right? The body of Christ, Jerusalem, Jeshurun in all her glory. That's what we're getting here in Hebrews 12, 22. But they're now come into the innumerable company of angels. So back in Matthew 22, for those who take part in the resurrection shall be as the angels of God in heaven. And for me, that's what we're getting here in Hebrews 12, 22. So for me, everybody in the body of Christ, this applies to in Hebrews 12, 22. But where I'm being led right now is that this may be also pertaining to a different group of people, in particular within the body of Christ. But this for me is most certainly a manifestation of Matthew 22, 30. You shall be as the angels of God in heaven, because now they've come into the innumerable company of angels, because they are as the angels of God in heaven, and now they're going to burn bright as the stars of God in the firmament, right? Because they're going to bring many to righteousness. So who are they? Who are the Hebrews? Are they different? Are they different to the rest of the body of Christ, or does it apply to all the body of Christ? It's not people over in a little sliver of land with a big black hat and wear cubes on their foreheads, right? It's not that. So who are the Hebrews? Who's the book of Hebrews actually directed to? Now check out verse 23, and this is the thing. This is the thing. To the general assembly. So for me, that's the body of Christ. The general assembly is everybody that's taking part in the resurrection who the second death has no power. For me, that is that's the general assembly. And we get that word end. I see this word end in the scriptures, and I get vexed about how to read it. Is this saying that the general assembly and the church of the firstborn are two different things, or is it saying that the general assembly is actually the church of the firstborn? Are they the same thing, or are they different? Now, where I'm heading here is that this is Romans 8 for me. This is the firstborn that we read in Romans 8. And this is what I've been trying to avoid to say. That's what I'm saying in Romans 8 is that's the church of the firstborn, the first fruits. The church of the firstborn, that's what we're getting here. So everybody that's redeemed, everybody that takes part in the regeneration, in the resurrection, they come into the general assembly. But these Hebrews here, for me, are also coming into the church of the firstborn because they're the firstfruits. They're different. These are the firstfruits that Daniel is talking about as well, that are going to burn as brightly as the stars in heaven, because now they are as the stars of God. They're now as the angels of God in heaven. But they've got their first. These Hebrews have got their first. And in 23, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect. So for me, I see the spirits of just men made perfect is the general assembly. For me, I'm quite settled on that. That's pertaining to the same thing. But is everybody that's going into the church, that's going into the general assembly and to the spirits of just men made perfect, are they all the church of the firstborn? Now, if everybody's of the first of the church of the firstborn, that means there's nobody born after the firstborn. So everything I'm saying now here has just become mute. But that word firstborn, so my brother, I've got a brother, he's the firstborn of my parents. He's the firstborn. Now, if he was if he had no brothers or sisters, he'd be an only child. Yeah, he's the firstborn, but he's the only child. I see that he's the firstborn because there's, I don't know, you could go either way, because he was always the firstborn. Mum and Dad would have said, he's my firstborn. But I see just the nature of that word, first, means that there's going to be a second, there's going to be a third. The Lord Jesus Christ is the firstborn, but then there's going to be there's going to be members of the body of Christ that are going to ensue after him, that are going to be born, that are come into that church after him. So that's the thing. The Romans 8, was it verse 29 or 30? And Hebrews 12 here and verse 23, that's the critical element. Are there forerunners? For me, I'm absolutely seeing that there are, as I again ask the question, has anybody in your history had the same ferocity of your love of the truth, of your love of the scriptures, your love of the Lord Jesus Christ, that's had anywhere near as powerful testimony as you've had? Because for me, I'd be drawn to them. If I saw anybody like that, and I even got a whiff of it, I'd be over there like a shot, because you knew you wouldn't be rejected, and you know the conversation you're going to have is intense. But for me, I sit at that place most days, and I sit there and read my Bible, and I've been doing it now for a couple of years, and I get very, very few people. I probably had two or three in my whole time that have come up to me to talk to me because I'm reading the Bible. I've had people come up to me, but very few, because I'm reading the Bible. So that tells me that there's nobody else like it around. The firstborn, right? The firstborn. Because we're doing for me things that I've never experienced other people do to me in all my time on planet Babylon. So there's that, right? So that's where I'm being led. So the firstborn. I've said what I've said about it, right? That's the critical element. That's the critical element. Are there others after the firstborn? You will be the firstborn among many brethren. Is that it? Or are there going to be more born after that? For me, there's absolutely more born after that. Now, in verse 24, we're also coming to Jesus, right? We're coming to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. So we've come into Mount Zion, the throne. We've come into the heavenly Jerusalem, the temple, the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit, into the innumerable company of angels, because those who take part in the resurrection shall be as the angels of God in heaven, to the general assembly, because everybody in the body of Christ comes to the general assembly, which is the spirits of just men made perfect, so brothers and sisters. But we're also getting this church of the firstborn, which I'm seeing is, they're the firstborn. The firstborn among many brethren. Now, as I say, I'm seeing an absolute progression going on in the book of Hebrews. And again, I ask the question, who are these Hebrews? Who are they? As I say, it's not blokes with a big black hat who run around with a sense of entitlement with a cube on their head. It's not them. It's not them. The Hebrews are somebody. It's been addressed to the Hebrews, just like I'm being led to think that the church of the Galatians and the Corinthians and the Romans, they're all somebody. And they're not just buildings that are just ruinous heaps now. They're collectives of people. So we've got 12 tribes of Israel, which tells me that everybody in the body of Christ is a tribe of Israel. Those who take part in the regeneration are going to sit upon 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Thrones, right? Thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. I'm seeing those thrones as hearts. So every one of the tribes of Israel have a heart. We've also got 12 spirits, 12 fruits of the Spirit. I'm starting to think now potentially that each tribe of Israel represents one fruit of the Spirit, and that's the throne. That's the heart of each of each tribe of Israel, right? So the Hebrews, I can't quite remember how I got onto there because I got so much coming in, but that's what I see. That's most certainly what I see. All of these, they have to be somebody. Oh, the different churches. So those different churches potentially represent something. And the Church of Ephesians, of course, it's one of the seven churches in Asia, one of the candlesticks that has their own star, that has their own angel. So who are they? Who are the Hebrews? So check this out now in Hebrews 1. So Hebrews, there's a lot of talk of angels right through the book of Hebrews, particularly the first couple of chapters. Now, we're talking about the Lord Jesus Christ being made a little lower than the angels. And we get this in verse 13 and 14. But to which of the angels said he at any time, sit at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool? So we're talking about the Lord Jesus Christ saying, talking about angels, as it pertains to angels. Of which of the angels? No, he's not an angel. He's above the angels, right? So we're talking about angels in any case. Are they not all ministering spirits? Right, so who are the Hebrews? And why is the author of Hebrews saying this to the Hebrews when they're going into Mount Zion, into the General Assembly and the Church of the Firstborn, into the innumerable company of angels and to the spirits of just men made perfect? Why is the author of Hebrews talking about who angels are? Angels are ministering spirits, right? Are they not all ministering spirits spent forth to minister them who shall be heirs of salvation? Now, the angels, the spirits of just men made perfect, I'm being led to think. That's what we're talking about here. The angels we're talking about here are the Holy Spirits, the ministering spirits who are keeping us in the way. The ministering spirits. So the author of Hebrews is telling the Hebrews that's what the Holy Spirits do. That's what the angels do. They're sent forth to minister them who are the heirs of salvation, right? The Hebrews. So again, I ask the question, who are the Hebrews? Because now we get this one. We'll go into verse 5, chapter 5 actually. But we'll go from 11. Of whom? We have many things to say and hard to be uttered, seeing you are dull of hearing. For when the time you ought be teachers, right? Teachers, ministers of the heirs of salvation, but they're getting a rebuke here. The Hebrews. Who are the Hebrews? For when you ought be teachers, you need that one teach you again from the first principles of the oracles of God, and to become such as have the need of milk and not of strong meat. So they're still babes in Christ. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age. I find that fascinating. Full age for me means that you're full. That's it. You're Jeshurun. You don't actually get the meat until then. Even those who by reason of use to have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. That was the sin in the Garden of Eden, and for me that's part of the glorious promise. So the Hebrews have been told that the angels, the Holy Spirits, are ministering spirits that have been sent forth to the heirs of salvation. Now I almost said Paul. The author of Hebrews in chapter 5 is rebuking them, saying, you should be teachers by now. What are you doing? What's the hold up? You should be teachers, because they should be ministering to the heirs of salvation. Because in Hebrews 12, remember, that's where they're coming into. They're coming into the spirits of just men made perfect, the General Assembly, the innumerable company of angels, but to also to the Church of the Firstborn. So that's why I'm being led to think in Hebrews 1, that's why the author of Hebrews is telling the Hebrews what angels are, because that's who they're going to become, and they're the Church of the Firstborn. They're the firstborn among many brethren. You see where I'm going? They have to be someone. And as I say again, I'm not saying anything apart from I'm asking questions and I'm putting down where I'm being led. I've been seeing this for a while, and just with this, all of this new information that's been coming in, because Daniel talks about this. I missed this scripture in Daniel. This one's really, really well known, and it come into me hard pretty well straight away. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. So at the time of the end, knowledge shall be increased. Now, this is happening to most certainly me, and what I'm seeing with other people who I'm blessed enough to have them share their testimony, their office with me, it's happening to you as well. It's happening to us as individuals, and it's happening to us at a collective. Now, for me, the time of the end, can that pertain to each person's own private, own progression of faith? Or is it a certain period in time? For me, this is talking about a certain period of time, and that's the end. And that knowledge is going to be increased. And that's what's happening now, as we in the body of Christ are doing things to others, things are happening to us. This glorious progression of faith is happening to us that we haven't seen in others. And we're doing things to others, ministering the word of God, right? Ministering spirits, the Holy Spirit within. We're ministering the word, and we're drawing other believers to the Lord Jesus Christ as he presents them before us, right? The church of the firstborn, as knowledge becomes increased, and we all know by now that we're living in the most profound times. It's unprecedented what's going on planet Babylon right now. And has it been going on in the body of Christ? Has this been going on for all eternity? Remembering that Elijah went up to the whirlwind in heaven, and for me, Enoch was translated, he had the progression of faith. Now, this is the progression that I'm talking about in Hebrews. We come into Hebrews 6:10. For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which you showed towards his name, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. Back in Hebrews 1, the angels, are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation? For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which you have shown toward his name, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. Now, this is after Hebrews 5, where they get the rebuke that they should be teachers by now, because that's what they are. The higher entities guarding the souls of men, they should be teachers, but they're dragging the chain. And now the author of Hebrews in Hebrews 6:10 is telling them that God will not forget what they're doing. The very same thing as the author of Hebrews have told the Hebrews what the angels are. They're ministering spirits sent forth to minister them who will be heirs of salvation. The church of the firstborn, right? Into the spirits of just men made perfect, and to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, this is where I absolutely, absolutely, absolutely am going to go to pains to say, you can see it's there. You can see why I'm being led to think these things. For me, it all hinges in Romans 8, is 29:30, that word firstborn. Firstborn. Is there a difference? Is there a firstborn in the church? Because that firstborn has been sent out into all the world to preach the gospel, to draw other believers to the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because for me, that's what's happening to us right now. Right this minute, that's what's happening to us. The ministering spirits sent forth. There's a progression going on in the book of Hebrews. For me, there's no doubt. It starts out. The author of Hebrews says, sometimes it'd be just easier to say Paul, but I can't say that because we don't know. But the author of Hebrews starts out as saying, tells them, these are what the Holy Spirits do. They're ministering spirits sent forth to minister to the heirs of salvation. In Hebrews 4 or 5, they get a rebuke because they're dragging the chain. They should be teachers. They should now be these ministering spirits, but it hasn't happened. You're still on the milk. You need to get onto the strong meat. You're dragging the chain. There's something holding you back. Then in Hebrews 6:10, what they have been described as, the ministering spirits, the angels, the Holy Spirits in Hebrews 1, That's what the author of Hebrews is saying. That's what they've been doing. They've been doing that very thing. And then they come into Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem, into the innumerable company of angels, because they're now as the angels of God in heaven, and they're going to burn as brightly as the firmament and as the stars in the heaven, because they've come, because that's what they are now. They're as the angels of God in heaven, because they've come into the spirits of just men made perfect, but they've also come into the church of the firstborn. So there's a separation, right? There's absolutely a separation going on.
Hello, Doc.
Now, as I say, this is where I really, really want to make it absolutely clear that this is just where I'm being led, and this is why I'm being led to think these things. I'm not saying anything apart from asking questions, asking you the question, Who are all these people? Who are the Hebrews? Does that word first fruits, does it pertain to that there's more? There's more fruits. Firstborn, sorry, that there's more born after the firstborn. The church of the firstborn. Is there a church of the subsequent born? Does everybody that come into the General Assembly, are they all part of the firstborn? And who are the Hebrews? And who are, we come into Revelation 14, who are the 144,000? They've got to be someone, right? Now, they've been set apart. They're different. They're different. They've been set apart from everybody else in the body of Christ. So what's the point of separation between the 144,000 and the rest of the body of Christ? There's a point of separation. What is it? There is a point of separation going on, and there's absolute similarities going on between the 144,000 and the Hebrews for me. And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood upon Mount Zion, right? So this is where the Hebrews have come into in Hebrews 12. They've come into Mount Zion. They've also come into Jesus. And that's what we're getting here. And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads. So who are they? Who are these 144,000? They're on Mount Zion, and we've got the Hebrews, and they're with the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's exactly what's happened with the Hebrews. The Hebrews have come into Mount Zion and to Jesus, and now we've got the 144,000. They're with Jesus on Mount Zion. Now, are we with Jesus on Mount Zion now? That's the thing. Are we there now? Or is this, have they reached the outcome of the progression of faith? For me, they've absolutely reached the outcome of the progression of faith, because they've been redeemed from among men, and they're the first fruits unto God and the Lamb. Now, does that mean that they're redeemed from among men? So does that, are we redeemed from among men at the moment? Or have they left the earth? That's my question here now. Have they left the earth? Have the Hebrews, because the Hebrews have gone into the spirits of just men made perfect. Now, I'm not perfected. For me, that's why I'm still on planet Babylon, is because I haven't been perfected. That's what I'm seeing here in Revelation 14. For me, they are the Hebrews. I see they've reached the outcome of the progression of faith, because in verse 5 as well, we get, and in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. So they're without fault. So just like Nathaniel, Nathaniel's a true Israelite, because in him is no guile. And that's what I'm being led to think Nathaniel could have been one of the 144,000, but I need to stay on track. But they're now, in their mouth is no guile, and they're without fault before the throne. Now, I can't say that about myself now. I certainly still have fault. I certainly still need to be redeemed. My progression of faith has not been yet completed. So this, for me, they're spirits. These now are spirits. These have come into the General Assembly and most certainly the Church of the Firstborn, because we get that in verse 4, where they're the first fruits unto God and the Lamb. So it's that different word. It's that word that we get it also in Hebrews, earlier in Hebrews, the first fruits. Not, doesn't say firstborn, but for me, they are the first fruits to God, because this is the church of the firstborn. The 144,000 for me are where the Hebrews have come into. They've come into Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem, to the spirits of just men made perfect, the general assembly, and to the church of the firstborn. That's now where those 144,000 are. So this is after Hebrews 12. That for me is who the Hebrews is actually addressed to. The progression in Hebrews and this 144,000 now, for me, this is the church of the firstborn, and they're the ministering spirits who have been sent forth to minister to the heirs of salvation. So I'll just say that just for now. There's much more, but I'm sort of times my enemy at the moment, and there's a couple more things that I want to put down now. That's at least worthy to consider, right? Who are the Hebrews? They have to be somebody. And who are the 144,000? They also have to be somebody. And what's the point of division? Why are the 144,000 being set apart from everybody else? The 144,000, right? I did the math on this the other day. I'll put it up on screen. It was something like 1 in 50,000 or 100,000 people or something. If their numbers, what they're saying on planet Babylon, there's 7 billion people, 144,000. If the 144,000 are all on the earth at the end of all things, because they've been redeemed from among men, and they're the first fruits unto God and the Lamb. So that tells me that, I don't know, it doesn't necessarily say that they were from the earth, but being redeemed from among men, that absolutely tells me that, like, there's men in heaven, but at least I'm led to think it's pertaining to the earth. They've been taken from the earth, the church of the firstborn, the 144,000, and if they're left standing at the end, if that's who's actually left standing at the end, the 144,000, it would be about like 1 in 50,000 or 150,000, 1 in 50,000 or 1 in 100,000. I'll put it up on screen. But if that's the case, that then tells me that there's a difference between the 144,000 and other people who don't take the mark of the beast at the end. But do the 144,000 actually leave before? Do the church of the firstborn actually leave before? Just questions, right? Actually leave before, and that's the church of the firstborn. That's the Hebrews going into Mount Zion, because they're now the ministering spirits who have been sent forth to minister to the heirs of salvation. So are they up there now? Or is it in the future? And who are they? And for me, that's that point of separation. I see that's the point of separation, because they're the firstborn. It's happened to them first. And now, because they've gone through it, just like the Lord Jesus Christ, we can't say to God, well, you don't know what it's like. You've never been through this. He has, because that's why he made a body for himself, that body being the Lord Jesus Christ. God was made manifest in the flesh, the Lord Jesus Christ. He lived it. He knows it. And that's what, for me, would be absolutely, like, talk about ideal. You've got these ministering spirits who are now going to be ministering to the heirs of salvation, because they've been through it. They've been through the same thing. The angels don't know. The angels don't know what it's like to be an earth dweller, what it's like, and the challenges of living in the flesh, right? So I'll leave it there just for now, but there's a couple more scriptures here I wanna deal with, and I'm just gonna keep going despite what's going on with time, right? So Mark 16, I've been sharing this a little bit of late, and I'll just consider this. This is how Mark ends. And afterward he appeared to the 11 as they sat at meat, and upbraided them for their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. But he said unto them, Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. So it happened then, right? It happened then. Is this now also a prophecy for the body of Christ? Is this now a prophecy to the church of the firstborn? That's what I'm testing right now. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, and he that believeth not shall be damned. All these signs shall follow them that believed. In my name they shall cast out devils, and they shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, so the healing of hands, giving the Holy Spirit, and they shall recover. So then after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God, the strength of the body of Christ of the church. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word and signs following. Amen. So is this the church of the firstborn? Is this a prophecy to the body of Christ? Because when we apply that now in Matthew 24, things just get just that little bit interesting, because we all know what Matthew 24 is, right? Because they ask him, they sat on the Mount of Olives, the olive piece. The disciples came unto him privately saying, tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? The end of the world, right? So we come back now into Daniel 12 and verse 4. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book even to the time of the end, and many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. So at the time of the end, knowledge shall be increased. And for me, we're getting in verse 3, this potentially is the church of the firstborn, because they're turning many to righteousness, and they're going to burn as bright as the stars in heaven and as the firmament, because they're now come into Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem, into the spirits of just men made perfect, because they're now as the angels of God in heaven. But verse 4 is telling us that knowledge shall be increased at the end. At the end. Now, Matthew 24, they're asking the Lord Jesus Christ about when these things shall be and the end of the world. And the Lord Jesus Christ answers them, says, take heed that no man deceive you, right? So the Lord Jesus Christ here is talking about the end. He's not talking about his first coming. He's not talking about the resurrection. He's talking about the end of the world, because that's the question. In verse 3, what shall be the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? So it's not when he was there then. This is in the future when he comes back, the man of sorrows and the man of glory. So this is the end. This is when knowledge shall be increased that Daniel's talking about. Now, I'll pick it up at verse 7. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. So pestilences are the unclean spirits. They're the sicknesses, the devils that infest people's lands. I see earthquakes in diverse places could be potentially fractured relationships that are destroyed and fractured that you never thought would be, potentially. Because I'm being led to think that earthquakes on the earth, there's more to consider with them. I don't see biblical earthquakes are earthquakes on the earth. There's something deeply sinister about earthquakes on the earth, because the globe earth is a lie, and the explanation of earthquakes upon planet Babylon is that the tectonic plates shift. And to me, there's no such thing as a tectonic plate. The Holy Spirit, the Lord God, would not make an earth with tectonic plates. Tectonic plates for me are the problem you get when you try to take a flat surface and make it into a ball. It's got these weaknesses. So I see earthquakes, there's much, much more to consider. Then they shall deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. I get conflicted with that, because the Lord Jesus Christ says not even a hair of our head shall fall to the earth. We're going to be fine. No one's going to be able to touch us. But here we're getting that we shall be killed. And we also get a scripture in Revelation that the beast is going to overcome. They're going to overcome the body of Christ. And that scripture in Thessalonians, for me, says that I'm being led to think the son of perdition is the beast. He's actually going to be sitting in the temple of God. that beast is actually going to infest the body of Christ somehow. So there's much, much more to consider. And then shall many be offended? So that's the middle name of Planet Babylon right now. If you're offended, you win the debate, you win the discussion, and you're no longer open to any scrutiny whatsoever because you're offended. Many shall be offended, and also in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what this more is pertaining to for me. They're offended. You talk about the Lord Jesus Christ at all, and they'll be offended. I know when I was growing up, it was much more socially acceptable to talk about Jesus than what it is now. It's become a bad, naughty, dirty word. Jesus, the Lord Jesus Christ on planet Babylon right now. So many shall be offended in his name and shall betray one another and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many. Now that to me is the cornerstone of sin. The cornerstone of sin is deception. And these false prophets, they're claiming to have the testimony and they're going to deceive many people. They're the harlots that are going to deceive these people, and they're going to go down alive into the pit. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Now get this. But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. So how do we overcome the world? We overcome the world by faith in our testimony, faith in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, faith and that core belief that Jesus is the Son, he's the anointed, he's the Messiah, he's the Son of God, and he's been sent by the Holy Spirit to be the Messiah, by the Lord God, the Holy Spirit, to be the Messiah, and that the Lord God raised him up after the third day. Be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. As our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, we overcome the world by our faith, and we as sons and joint heirs shall sit upon the throne of the Lord Jesus Christ as he sits upon the throne of the Lord God, as we become one in another, as the Lord Jesus Christ and the Father are one, we all become one in another, and those who overcome shall inherit all things, and it's only they that endure to the end, the shame shall be saved. Now get this in verse 14, because this rolls together everything or a lot of what I've been saying now. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto the nations, and then the end shall come. So who is going to preach the gospel for this witness just before the end comes, right? Is it the church of the firstborn? And again, I ask you the question, have you had anybody in your whole life that's had anywhere near the testimony that you have, that has your love of the truth, has your love of the Holy Spirit, and has your love of the scriptures? Has anybody come to you with those things? And has anybody ever spoken to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ the way now you're finding yourself talking to others as the Holy Spirit draws these potential believers to you? And who shall believe? That's what we get in Mark. Who will believe will inherit eternal life, and who don't believe will be condemned. And in Luke 10, the Lord Jesus Christ says, when you shake the dust from your feet, you go into every house and you eat what's before you. So you talk to them on their level. And those who receive you, and you go to that house, peace be unto you. You talk to them on their level, and whosoever receive you, you lay on the hands and you heal the sick. You give them the Holy Spirit by the laying on of hands, spiritual laying on of hands. And you say to them, blessed be thou because the kingdom of God's come unto you. But those who don't receive you, woe unto them. But be it known, you know, I don't say these words, nothing like that. It's a spiritual, it's all spiritual. Woe unto you because the kingdom of God's come unto you and you haven't received me. Because later in the chapter, the Lord Jesus Christ says that. Whoever doesn't receive us doesn't receive him. And who doesn't receive him that sent him. The sent preachers that have been sent to preach the gospel, I'm being led to think the church of the firstborn who have been sent to minister to the heirs of salvation, because we get in Matthew 24, this gospel is going to be preached as a witness to the nations. You're either going to believe or you're not going to believe. So who's going to preach it, right? who's going to preach it. So as I say, a little while ago, yesterday when I was down here, probably about an hour ago now on the video, it's here. It's just a thought at the moment, but it's here, right? I haven't tried to make this happen. I haven't tried to manipulate this. I've been seeing this in these scriptures for a long time. And now with all of this new knowledge the Holy Spirit's been giving me over the last couple of months, particularly since I got sick, it's become so very profound that when I got sick, that I look back, I watched part of that video the other day where I sat in this very spot, and it was the day when I got sick again that night. It's just, my goodness, some of the most profound experiences of my life, that I have not been that sick in a long, long time. And it just came out like a bolt from the blue. It just came from nowhere. In fact, I don't ever remember being that sick. It was absolutely monumental. Absolutely monumental. Didn't last long, but it was intense. As since that point, I've just had this most intense experience going on. Knowledge getting increased, right? Knowledge getting increased. But it's there, right? I'm not trying to manipulate it. It's there. But as I say, it's just... I ask thee, what thinketh you? 144,000 in the Hebrews have to be someone. And for me, the 144,000 are set apart for something. And we're clearly, for me, we're getting sent preachers. We're getting a church of the firstborn. And they're going to know more than other people. And they're going to draw believers. And for me, it hasn't happened to us. Anyway, that's where I'm at. So it's been a remarkable video, this. It's just gone off into a completely different direction to what I expected. Wowee, right? I've hardly even touched the run sheet, but I'll pick it up. Yeah, I'll keep going, I think, next video. So I'll be still here at the park. I'm starting to think I'm just going to be doing park videos now forever. Unbelievable, right? Anyway, I'm down to 10%, so I've got I've got to wind this up. So I want to finish today on a calendar verse. Now I've got to cover it, because for some reason on a Saturday I don't want to make sure I'm not doing nothing dodgy with my hand here, right? I don't want people to think anything, so I've got to cover that up, right? Psalm 56:11, in God have I put my trust, I will not be afraid what man can do unto me. How about that, right? As I get my phone for voting, in God do I put my trust. I trust my testimony. I trust in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I ain't going to be afraid what man can do to me. Unwavering faith, right? I've just read Psalm 51, and that's what I may be talking about next video. I'm not sure. I've just had the most remarkable morning in the Psalms. And sometimes when something clicks in for me, a new piece of the puzzle clicks in, I think, well, that was just obvious. I feel a bit stupid for not knowing that. A big part of this puzzle piece that I was potentially overlooking, but I wasn't giving it the importance of the other elements, is that we need repentance for the Holy Spirit to come in. But a critical element is that God forgives us. Wisdom of God and the wisdom of man, right? God forgives our sin. Why does God forgive our sin? It's so the Holy Spirit can be made manifest in us. Our inheritance is the Lord. The Lord's inheritance is His people. The Spirit of truth. It was a massive revelation for me. And then it might have been Psalm 65. I'll put it up on screen, those first two verses. It all just come to life. He wants us dead in sin. He wants us dead in sin so that we repent and we search and we ask Him for the wisdom of God, the wisdom of heaven. He forgives our sins so that the Holy Spirit can move in, so that we die, so the glory of God is manifest in His people as He sits upon His throne, which is the glory of His people, the glory of God being made manifest in the body of Christ. Thus, the glory of the Lord is made manifest in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ and his body. It was amazing. And I do feel like coming down to the park and just reading from Psalm 51. It was absolutely incredible, and I'm quite confident I'm actually getting the right number. So that's me, my brothers and sisters. I hope and pray it wasn't too controversial. That's where I'm being led. I've been led in this direction for quite some time, and as I've said a few times, it's now that I've had all this new information come in, that's what I'm saying. All right, that's me. A remarkable video, a very, very different video, and I just, knowledge is most certainly increasing, right? Who are the church of the firstborn? Who are the firstborn? Who are the 144,000? They're all got to be somebody, and I'm seeing a point of separation in them all, because I'm seeing that they're all actually the same thing. The church of the firstborn, the 144,000, the sent preachers, the ministering spirits that are going to be heirs of salvation. I just marvel at what's coming and exactly how we're going to be used. I just absolutely marvel. All right, my brothers and sisters, I'm going to get out of here because I know time is, it's always against me, right? It is always against me. All right, my brothers and sisters, it is indeed a wonderful time to be alive, a wonderful, glorious time to be in the body of Christ, and to He goes all the power and all the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Woo! Ho-ho! The King!
Heaven and earth will disappear, but my words remain forever. But no one knows the date and hour when the end will be, not even the angels, no, nor even God's Son. Only the Father knows. The world will be at ease, banquets and parties and weddings, just as it was in Noah's time before the sudden coming of the flood. People wouldn't believe what was going to happen until the flood actually arrived and took them all away. So shall my coming be. Two men will be working together in the field, and one will be taken, the other left. Two women will be going about their household tasks, one will be taken, the other left. So be prepared, for you don't know what day your Lord is coming.
Life was filled with guns and war, and everyone got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready. Children died, the days grew cold. A piece of bread could buy a bag of gold. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come, you've been left behind. Change your mind, the sun has come.